Well, I don't know either. I'll find out when you do it. I'm open to it. I would love to learn.
I can see. Well, we'll see. Anyway, are you free for Monday, Thursday,
yeah.
Yeah. I forgot my other glasses. No, here they are. So we'll have to wait till the end to see whether you have another lecture.
Oh yeah, but I think you explained it. My plan is to explain how things are structured.
That's all right. And if you get half explained and you fill time, you might as well go on. And if you go on, if it turns out, it depends a lot on how much they talk, and you never know until it happens. Okay. But whichever way, whether you finish or not, or get half through, you know, and only need half Thursday, that's okay. Anything is okay. James, I have something important for you. We start a minute. I've got the thing scanned, and it's over at the Comedy Center, and I don't see why I have to go pick it up.
And the cars are bigger.
For you, and the RCF. They have my book too, so get there.
Okay, so on paper.
Yeah, right across.
All right, I'll get
it. Have you cleared with Rick, or Rick isn't around yet, to see whether he can do it then? We'll find out when we see him. He's coming today, in any case.
Okay.
When are you going to come and see me?
I'm putting this together. I have to go get a medication around noon. Yes, I'm going to tell him. I may not be there, but I might have to.
You better talk to him.
Olivia, am I going to tell you how to drive? Because I have to go to the pharmacy. So next week, I thought. Well, I'll talk about it.
Okay. Does anybody understand this? It's telling me record. I don't see the pause, unpause. Anybody got a good feel for these little gadgets when I say, wait, he says push play.
That's working.
It's working now.
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. Yeah? Yeah. Okay. So now, as planned, Olivia is going to talk about the sexuality chapter. I will be on the edge of my seat because I didn't think there was enough in there to assign it. And he thinks there's enough in there for two lectures. We will see how it turns out. In any case, I'll tell you, we will find out either by the end of today whether he's going to go on and talk about it more on Thursday, which is okay with me, or whether I'm going to talk about the Cogito on Thursday, or maybe we'll split it. But I can't tell till we see how things go so far. So now I turn it over to Olivier. But I'm looking at something while I'm here. Is this set up for PowerPoint? I'm asking because Eric is going to give us a lecture, but Eric needs PowerPoint. That looks like PowerPoint. You can set it up. That looks like it's all ready to go. Okay. Okay, we could. We'll work on it.
Eric, can you open the window next to you or whoever's over there? And Alva? That's what she called it. 20. Oh, that's good. Okay. Okay, Olivia.
So first of all, don't hesitate to ask questions. If I think it's better to answer the questions after I finish, say what I'm just explaining, I will tell you, but don't hesitate anyway. I will comment the text. So it follows the way Moloporti develops his arguments. And I'll try to show that it might have an, this chapter might have an interest.
That's the question.
And I think for this, the first sentence is very important. The one that...
Now let me try. Should I go along and call out the page numbers on the...
I have the...
You have it.
Yeah, thanks. And this first sentence says, our constant aim is to elucidate the primary function whereby we bring into existence for ourselves, or take a hold upon, space, the object or the instrument, and to describe the body as the place where this appropriation occurs. So this we have to have in mind for the whole, to understand the whole chapter, because the thing is, globally stated, Merleau-Ponty's aim in the whole first part of the book on the body is to show that, as he puts it somewhat metaphorically, most of the time, there's what he calls the current or the flow of existence. That runs, this means existence, that runs through the body. And what this means is that you wouldn't have to think of the body as being only, say, the regulated by biological functions, or as being only the place where sensory motor contingency could be at work. The body encompasses all these different layers, including what Merleau-Ponty calls explicitly in this chapter sexual perception. So the thing is, this chapter is interesting. The first and I think the main reason why this chapter is interesting is that it helps us understand what Merleau-Ponty means by body, which could be a fuse, I think. Since the thing is, as it will turn out, and this is one of the big issues that Merleau-Ponty wants to bring forward, there's one identical in some way meaning for the term body that's similar throughout all these layers. So the body is that which endorses, say, all these dimensions of existence. And the thing is, as Merleau-Ponty explains it in the preface, in a very important paragraph, the question is, what is existence or how does it work? And existence is the way that things come to exist for us. So our existence is the way that we articulate, we organize, we give a form, similar expressions, to the world that's around us. So the existence of man, of the human being, what is it? It's made of what he calls operative intentionality.
That's in the preface?
Yeah.
Do you have the page number?
Probably in yours, it's page 20.
In yours.
13, yeah. Yours is 20.
The operative intentionality, you see it about 15 lines down on Roman numeral 20 for us.
Operative intentionality describes, stands for the fact that when we have behaviors or conducts, in the world, we organize it in such and such a way. And thus, certain parts of the world come to have some meaning for us. But what he states in the preface, and we need all this to understand what's going on. What he says in the preface is that his own meaning of intentionality, his proper definition of the concept, implies the body, precisely. Which means that the intentionality is not, and Bert has stressed this enough, I think, his intentionality is not to be conceived of as something that starts from representations, that then are the cause or the motivation for a behavior. What we experience when we're in the world is that we're being motivated by the world. This is what it means when he says we're the embodied subject is a part of the system of the world itself. We're just articulating the world and all these relations he has. What this means is that it's not as if meanings or representations were in the head motivating what we're doing. It's that you have this situation A that you experience as motivating a behavior that leads to our conduct that leads to this situation B. So this is what, I mean, this is very important to have in mind, since Merleau-Ponty ultimately says at the end of the second part, the last sentence of the second part of the book, is that everything relies on time and on the flow of time. And so in the time chapter, he goes even as far as to say that the operative intentionality is that which we experience as relating or as motivating the passage of time itself. So it's that by which our behavior has a unity of time. So this is, and the last part of this framework that you have to have in mind is that, as I just said, it's not as if the operative intentionality was starting from mental representations. We can only act following the operative intentionality because we are embodying the world. We come back to the body, and this is the end of this sort of sketch of the body that I wanted to draw in the first place. So we cannot act in the world without the body, and the body is that by which we are being receptive to the stimulations that come from the world. Okay. It means that without the body there could be no subject, because we couldn't be subjectively, intentionally, the two terms being the same, behaving. And on this framework, with this framework, with the help of it, we can understand, I think, why this chapter is interesting, because if you see what Merleau-Ponty states in the very first paragraph of this chapter, The Body and Its Sexual Being, Merleau-Ponty clearly says that the existence of something for me, the way I articulate the world, this very functioning sort of the existence can be understood as well if we consider, and this is the last sentence, yeah, let us try to see how a thing or a being begins to exist for us through desire or love, and we shall thereby come to understand better how things and beings can exist in general. Is the last sentence of the first paragraph of this chapter. So it means that Merleau-Ponty is clearly integrating, replacing sexuality within the framework of operative intentionality, that by which things come to exist for us. And as we will see, this existing other things for us by operative intentionality as being mediated by the body, as he says in the first sentence that I read. Describe the body as the place where this appropriation occurs. So the appropriation, something comes to have a meaning for me, thanks to the body. And this happens because the body is the perceiving subject. So the meaning of perception and the meaning of the term perception and of the term body are clearly related. And Melamonti wants to stress the fact that in every dimension of existence, they are related. So this is why he will advocate for a specificity of the sexual perception within the framework of the existence that encompasses all these dimensions. And to do this, he starts, as usual, you remember what Sean said when he gave his lecture on the thing. To do this, he begins by stressing the fact that there are two positions that you wouldn't want to follow because they don't respect this embodied framework. And as usual, these positions are the empiricist position and the intellectual. And the first one and the paragraphs are very long in this chapter, particularly long. But the first 1.5 page, just following the very short first paragraph, deals with these two positions and how they're wrong, using, once again, Schneider, the patient from Gilbert and Goldstein. Very briefly stated, because I don't want to spend too much time on this, because it's how Melamonti describes the experiments and Schneider's case, but what we should be more interested in are his conclusions. The thing is, he says you can't conceive of what he will come to call the erotic life or sexuality as being only related to anatomical or organic processes, which would be the empiricist account. That would mean everything that happens in sexual life would be more or less elaborated reflexes. So this part of the body reacts because of this or this stimulation. This would be the empiricist account. And the intellectualist or mentalist, account of this would be that there's the experience of pleasure and pain, but there's nothing to be said about it until it becomes, so what's the English for this? Well, shot through at the, it's the second sentence of the second paragraph, shot through with intelligence, which would mean that to be the mind that would have to give a content to the experiences of pleasure and pain, right? So mostly pleasure, hopefully, for sexuality. And hence that, it would mean that there are no specific sexual stimulations. So of course, presented this way, it can seem to be absurd, but that's the two positions between which Melamonti wants to add his own, the third way, the way of existence. So this intellectualist position is, okay, well, he says about four sentences from the beginning, apart from experience of pleasure and pain, of which there's nothing to be said, the subject stands out by his power of representation, and affectivity is not recognized as a distinctive form of consciousness. So it means that if one conceives of affective life that is behaving, sexual behaviors, as having its meaning only thanks to the work of the intellect or the mind, then you can't say that sexual behaviors are in themselves or correspond to a certain dimension as Mother Porter puts it, original dimension of life. Am I being clear? Am I being clear so far?
Yeah.
Yeah.
You might write bigger. Can you read that from the back? You can. Don't write it.
Yeah, even better, maybe.
Yeah,
I might be even better.
That's right. Try smaller.
Okay, so obviously this way, this way of dealing with perception, sexual perception, that is sexual behavior, won't satisfy Mother Porter because he wants to stress, on the contrary, that affective life and sexual behavior is some original mode of consciousness. Well, that's a very good example of a sentence that one would have to understand the right way. It doesn't mean that the consciousness is constituting in an intellectual way the sexual life, otherwise he would be having the intellectualist account for it. Here, consciousness means that that's the way we consciously live, experience sexuality. But it doesn't mean that we have to have representations for this. So then he goes on in describing what happens to Schneider, which I won't develop for itself. But the thing is, because it's stressing the fact that these two approaches are incomplete, what I'm interested in is the conclusion. So it's the sentence that begins with pathology brings to light. So for you it would be, So he says pathology, and this is how he kind of puts forward the his approach of it, giving the solution of this dialectical dilemma. Pathology brings to light somewhere between automatic response and representation, a vital zone in which the sexual possibilities of the patient are elaborated, in the same way as we saw above, as are his motor, perceptual, and even intellectual possibilities. There must be imminent in sexual life some function which ensures its emergence, and the normal extension of sexuality must rest on internal powers of the organic subject. There must be an eros, or a libido, which breathes life into an original world, gives sexual value or meaning to external stimuli, and outlines for each subject the use he shall make of his objective body. So it means that, as Mother Porter will clearly say it a few lines after, that sexuality, as being an original dimension of life, is as such related to what Mother Porter calls, I'm going to write very big, the intentional arc. He says it at the very end of this huge paragraph, which is the last sentence, actually, of the paragraph.
182.
We discover both that sexual life is one more form of original intentionality, and also bring to view the vital origins of perception, motility, and representation by basing all these processes on an intentional arc, which gives way in the patient, and which, so it means it's not working for Schneider, and which in the normal subject and those experienced with its degree of vitality and fruitfulness. So what Mother Porter wants to stress two things at the same time in this paragraph is that you have to consider sexuality as being one of the dimensions of existence, But nevertheless, as being original, even though you have to relate it to this flow or current of existence.
Could you just comment on what you mean by living?
Yeah, I think the way to understand it is to relate it to what Merleau-Ponty said, that the sentence that I read previously when he says that you have to conceive of affectivity as an original mode of consciousness. So, well, concretely, what would it mean? It would mean that when you're, say, to use what he says about Schneider, when you're facing a woman and when you're Schneider, so when you have heterosexual orientations, then it would, you could suppose that Schneider should be experiencing immediately a certain type of stimulation that would prescribe, or that he would feel prescribing him, some sort of behavior. And this immediacy, the fact that it should be for a normal subject, obvious that this kind of sexual behavior is called for by the situation. This would be the original thing. It would mean that in certain types of situations, the sexual dimension of life is experienced as being the only way you could live in. So you don't even think about what you're going to do. It calls for what Merleau-Ponty calls certain powers or certain attitudes of the subject. So it would mean that you wouldn't have to elaborate it.
So original means immediate and basic?
Yeah.
Are there other originals that might help? If we had other examples of original.
Yeah, well, the other examples, it's good. Yeah, all those, yeah, that's right.
What, the biological, the perceptual?
Yeah, the sensory motor perception, for example.
And that's it? Or there are more than, are there three then?
Are there non-original forms of intentionality? Objective thought, would that be it?
Well, actually, no, it couldn't. Because if you see what he's, I think, well, the thing is, the formulations he gives of the intention, this is related to how many dimensions the intentional arc has, basically. And you can see that the formulation he gives of them slightly changed. But I think, you see here, it's at the very beginning of the third paragraph, he talks about the whole active and cognitive being as being two other sectors of life along with, say, sexuality. So I think that the original dimensions are the one that go along with the intentional arc, basically.
And that means, for instance, just to try and get clearer, Heidegger thinks mood is the essential kind of affinity guide. Is mood an original something or other that Merleau-Ponty isn't talking about, or if not, what disqualifies it?
Well, I think it would be disqualified as a sort of original. Oh. In a way, I mean, he doesn't, and I think this is one of the reasons why he's been criticized so much by analytical philosophy, is that he doesn't systematize everything he says, sort of. So he's not making lists all the time, right? But I would say maybe no, because, well, at first sight, so to speak, maybe not, because it's not, in mood, it's not as obvious as in, say, sexual perception, or sensory motor regular perception, that the body comes in the first place.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So the metaphor, if you like, is that, oh, I had it very quickly, is that these capacities, say sexual capacity, is itself the source of meaning.
Yeah.
The source of significance.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's what is the origin of those things.
Yes, exactly.
What's origin, original, or originary? That
yes, sense. That's right. Yes. I wanted to say originary, but he doesn't say it. But, well, anyway, original and originary have the same meaning for him. It means both all the time. Yes?
I think we need to make a distinction between, you didn't put it this way, but I think. Perception versus action, or
it's not versus. Perception is a behavior, so
well,
we don't
I mean
have to make a distinction.
They're both kinds of intentionality, right?
Like it's the same.
Okay.
You act when you perceive.
But
because you move.
You did say the body is first, so he says that we've been talking about prepersonal existence and like anonymous existence and everything, and so I think there is like the basic level, like Rebecca was saying at the beginning of the course, but then through action, we endow the world with like more human significances and give our personal existence like a sense of historicity and like individuality, but that's all based on our bodily functions, which are so that's more passive, I guess, but then
No, you acquire more meanings. Well,
I mean, it's not really an important distinction, but
it's not the way he formulates it, so let me please.
Okay, go ahead. I mean,
yeah.
I don't know.
Because this is what he discusses afterwards.
He talks about it later. He says, I can close my eyes, lie down, listen to the blood pulsating in my ears, lose myself in some pleasure or pain.
Yes, yeah. Okay, but why does he say that?
Yeah,
this we have to know.
This is what we've all been, like, arguing
well,
about.
So yes, but it has a precise meaning in this chapter.
Yeah.
So you have to understand it in the context.
But I will come to this.
Okay.
Well, the thing is, otherwise, you just end up picking parts from here and there, and you don't understand why he talks about this or why he mentions it at this very moment. And the thing is that it's as Bert put it once, the book itself is a big gestalt because you can it's like Spinoza's ethics. You can find connections between all the chapters.
Yeah. So we're not gonna have time to cover each one of these chapters individually, so we might as well like get it all in right now. Sorry.
But I'm not sure everyone understood what you meant.
Well, I know,
so
but if we just keep talking, like everything will come clear impression.
I hope so. Certainly. It's connected, but I will come back to this later, if you don't mind. So, yes, the original dimensions of existence are the ways, basically they correspond to the different types of meaning that you can experience.
Different types of
meaning.
And that would disqualify mood, sort of.
Yeah.
Is not a kind of
because meaning is the way you interact with the world,
right,
in a bodily manner.
The mood is a way
so
of opening up the world, but it's not a way of giving specific meaning to specific situations.
And it's, yeah, because, well, it's not embodied in the same time.
Is that true, by the way? I mean, if you're depressed, then this thing has a different kind of meaning.
And it does seem to be, embodied. I'm not.
Yeah, this is why I said at first sight.
Right. Go on.
Yeah, because Merleau-Ponty says in the second part, for example, that of course the world appears different to you when you're depressed.
So then you might have to add it to that list.
Yeah. In a way, but maybe it means something different. Because I think that maybe Merleau-Ponty would say that, and maybe he says this somewhere that I don't have in mind yet, but maybe he would say that, say, the being depressed is a sort of, should rather be conceived of as a sort of withdrawal from the world. You're not that present to the world anymore, for example.
Let me try something which would be interesting. It's too global. That all these take some situation or some particular object or person to give meaning to. It isn't just everything at any time. Even the sexual, which is a whole dimension, a whole atmosphere, he says, doesn't make everything sexual, not the trees, for instance.
Yeah.
I mean, but when you're depressed, everything is depressed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, this withdrawal from the world goes along with a sort of confusion. Or Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
I know you want to move on. Let me just say just a quick thought in response to that. But you would think that there's no such thing as a sort of a mood neutral mental state. Every interaction with the world is colored by a background of mood, you know?
Right. But for that very reason, it seems to be a different sort of candidate than the ones on these lists, which are not only in the background, but always pick out something or other in the foreground as what's particularly significant or meaningful at that point, and perceive something.
Well, that's right, but on the same hand, the whole end of the chapter deals with what Merleau-Ponty calls ambiguity.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the fact that all these dimensions are always present together, but there's one that's being put forward.
Another aspect. Go ahead.
But no, it's deeply related to what we're discussing.
Oh, but it's a different problem than the one I was talking about, which is in a mood,
everything
gets covered.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. That's right.
whatever, these things, I think it's getting clearer, these original something or others are original forms of intentionality. I mean, they're directed at something specific under some aspect in a way that the depression is not directed at something specific under some aspect.
Okay, so this particular way of experiencing meanings that you experience are in the world and that you experience call for some particular action is, for example, described in a very concrete way by Merleau-Ponty. So this would be for you on page 180 still, just a few lines after what I've been reading in this book. It's in the case of the normal subject.
Yeah, about 20 lines from the bottom.
Okay. So it says, in the case of the normal subject, a body is not perceived merely as any object. This, and I come to the question that I haven't been answering at the moment. This objective perception has within it a more intimate perception. The visible body is subtended by sexual schema, which is strictly individual, emphasizing the erogenous areas, outlining a sexual physiognomy and eliciting the gestures of the masculine body, which is itself integrated into this emotional totality.
So this goes along with your question, so that's why I wanted to write.
Mm-hmm.
Because you have these different dimensions of bodily interaction with the world. But obviously, if you can't even perceive the things, you can't perceive, if you're Schneider, the woman that's in front of you. So it means that obviously there's a basic level that, well, we've been discussing this in the discussion groups, so that's partly where the question that's been raised came from. So of course there's a basic level that Merleau-Ponty calls pre-personal. And that he mostly deals with in the thing chapter. I won't give all the references all the time because otherwise I would just be.
That's
right. So, but I can send. And this level is the purely sensory motor level of perception. Pre-personal meaning doesn't have yet any human significance. At this very level, you wouldn't, or there would be no difference between, say, a potential sexual partner and a chair, for example. So that's, which means it's fairly an abstracted level, right? So this means that, as though this level is the first, because you need to perceive, and I mean what. Why does he talk about this mostly in the Think chapter? It's because it corresponds, and as well also in the chapter on the sensory experience, the first or the second part, because it corresponds to the qualia what the tradition calls secondary qualities, that's colors and brightness of sound and or color, and the perceptual consensus. Okay, so this pre-personal level is concerned with these. So it's a certain basic use of the body that's the minimal one, and it's the condition of the others. And actually, it's, of course, he just doesn't want to discuss this because to discuss the biological level, because to him, and well, I won't go into this very discussion for itself, but to him, the biological level alone cannot characterize perception. In perception, in human perception, that he's dealing with, I have to give a few other elements. But in human perception, even the prepersonal level already has one human fundamental dimension. It's that when you perceive something, and even just as having this or that shape and this or that color and brightness, to describe the thing you're perceiving, you would have to relate it to all of the context, to the whole context that surrounds it. So it would mean that you always perceive things, so say the chair, as being in the world, precisely, with this lighting and everything. So now I go back to what, towards everything Sean has been discussing. So there's this global dimension. It means that you can perceive the things for themselves, apart from your, say, biological needs. So this was just to say that the very first level of human experience, that's the pure sensory motor perception, and not the biological, because it would be too much laid in by the needs. And we as humans can separate ourselves from our needs and just look at what's around us. So that's basically what he means. And that's why it's the perceptual level, that's the first level of human experience. But it's pre-personal. It means that when you're during your life, you're not always experiencing explicitly human or you're not experiencing always personal, that would be erotic, for example, dimensions of the world. You can be concentrating on this layer, but still, I'm not discussing this more now because it's a completely different issue, but you have to know that he puts forward this pre-personal level, and it's very important here, because what he just said is that the visible body is attended by a sexual schema, which is strictly individual. So it means that, and also here he says that this visible body is attended. So you might want to think of the erotic dimension as being under in some way. Well, these are just metaphors, but as being under the purely perceptual sensory motor qualities of the things. Well, actually, considering this very scheme, this very pre-personal dimension, you'd rather say, and this corresponds to what Malebolge says in the rest of the book, that this erotic dimension supervenes on top of.
I'm still a little confused as to the distinction between pre-personal and a personal level. I assume that you also get a personal level. That
yeah, of course.
Out of this. What distinguishes the two exactly? I mean, what is the personal level? What makes the personal level personal and brings it out of the pre-personal?
The thing is, okay, if we discuss this, we have to enter a new
okay,
new issues.
So,
but then the thing is, you can never experience the pre-personal level alone. You can concentrate on the perception that you can have. You remember you weren't there when Sean was discussing this, but well, basically the thing is you can concentrate, so you can abstract from the human features of the situation, that would say the practical features of the situation, and you can just concentrate on this level, the level of the secondary qualities and the perceptual consensus. And this would be the pre-personal level. So the things have no human meaning for you, basically.
So
they're not like tools.
The pre-personal is without sense.
It's without human sense, but it has a sense, because what sense ultimately means for Merleau-Ponty is it's the dependence of the parts between themselves, and the fact that they depend on the whole. And that's why I discussed, very badly I agree with that, but that's why I mentioned the dependence of, say, one sensory quality to all the others. It's precisely because they depend
on each other. The color that you see depends on the lighting and everything. So there's a pre-personal meaning level or sense level.
I hate to make complications, but that kind of holism works for the animals too. The lighting level, presumably they also have brightness constancy and size constancy.
Yeah, well. So you want us to have again to have the discussion that we had again?
I still believe animals have. The equipmental totality is of course human, but with chairs and stuff. But are you saying? Is Merleau-Ponty saying, according to you, that animals are just zapped into some kind of affordances which don't have any global constancy?
Yes.
Really?
That they can concentrate on them.
Yeah. But there's no color constancy and brightness and size and all these.
The dimension that always comes forward in there. Well, and actually, and he says in the lectures on nature actually that you would have to. Well, he does that. He's not primarily an ethologist, so he wouldn't assert that. But still, that you might want to include the low developed monkeys to the sort of maybe the human level, but. The thing is that, yeah, he says, remember the text we've been discussing at the end of the first chapter of the first part. He says that the animals are always in a particular world. So they're drawn towards this world by immediately biological concerns. And that we humans can just sort of reflect on this pre-personal level and concentrate on it.
I agree to that.
That's what he says.
Sure, okay.
Isn't it a mistake to associate the pre-personal with secondary qualities and stuff? Because
no.
It's about, doesn't the pre-personal level account for awareness of things and objects and so on? The level of the natural world, right?
Yeah, well, and sensory qualities belong to the natural world from the point of view. There's no doubt about this.
But it also gives us primary qualities, right?
Yeah, that correspond to the perceptual constancies that I've mentioned.
So I don't understand what the secondary qualities is doing.
What the what?
So the idea that the pre-personal level gives us secondary qualities or something like that.
You were secondary up there, but that's what he's
working on. Yeah. Well, it seems like it gives us primary qualities as well.
Yeah, like the constancies.
Right. So what's distinctive what's distinctive in the pre-personal level about secondary qualities? What distinctive work are they doing in the pre-personal level?
I couldn't answer to this question, I think, for yourself now.
I think you probably mean something different by secondary. Why do
yes, I said. Well, I said that this is what the philosophical tradition has called secondary qualities. So it's not the shapes, say, of the objects, but their colors and everything. So that. All the color and the brightness and what's related to the fact that we have I call it this way because Merleau-Ponty separates them. He talks about these secondary qualities in the chapter on it's in your translation. It's probably sensory experience. Sense experience. The first of the second part. And then you have the perceptual constancies that he deals with in the chapter on the thing. So this is what I would relate it to, but I think I need to add forward now. Mm-hmm.
So there's a danger that we think of the pre-personal level is limited to secondary qualities or something like that.
But I just said the opposite for that it was including perceptual constancies and the shapes and the weight of the objects and
size and all that goes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The constancies.
That's right.
Right? I can hear you.
Sorry.
More brightness.
So tell me if I'm understanding you correctly. So the pre-personal level is basically being in the world with all the significance stripped away. It's like
not all the significance because precisely from the reporting, there's a significance that's purely sensory motor and perceptual. That's the way things depend on each other.
Okay.
When you perceive their shape and colors and everything.
Okay. Right, okay, yeah, that's, okay, no, that's too simple. So basically, we can never directly perceive the pre-personal level or whatever alone.
Well, you can sort of abstract from your practical concerns and concentrate on this very pre-personal level.
I mean, it seems like in the pre-personal...
But this is a task you're doing. So when you're coping and in flow and everything, you're never experiencing this level alone. Because
right.
what motivates your action is something of a personal
right.
level. That's the task you're accomplishing, basically.
But at the same time, the pre-personal level is always operating.
Yes.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you would just...
Yeah,
otherwise you'd be bumping in the tables
right.
when you want to do something else. Because
mm-hmm.
you wouldn't be taking into account the perceptual consensus and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Just like
but other people have been having cramps, I think. So, no, I have to go forward.
I mean, you can't have personal without pre-personal, just in one instance, with
the other people are in line. You have your
so you have to wait now.
I guess I just wanted to clarify, given what you said about the pre-personal here, in relation to these other categories, why original or originary doesn't just apply to this level?
Because you can have a genuine experience, immediate genuine experience of a situation that's directly, that which of a situation in which the dimension that's the most pregnant in it is the sexual dimension.
But based on what you said, that's only possible because of the sort of bare perceptual levels described as the pre-personal. I mean, that's what gives everything its sort of fundamental significance. And then there's these other layers.
Well, that's not what gives everything its fundamental significance. It's that which human or personal significance relies on. So it's not the same, because if you say this, you would, and in some way you would end up saying that the sexual perception is not original or originary in some way. So that's what Merleau-Ponty wants to stress by saying this. He wouldn't deny that if you meet your girlfriend, whatever, you're not, it's not a background part of your experience, the fact that, well, she has a body, and this body, as being also a physical and not only an erotical object, has dimensions that might not change suddenly. So, what you have to have in mind is what he wants to stress at that very moment. And the thing is that there has to be a way to account for the specificity of the sexual experience, even though it draws on this pre-personal level.
Okay.
One
thing that you want to
Okay, so that's what, because, well, you have to know that I won't give you the cause, because precisely what Merleau-Ponty says is that you wouldn't want to think of it in terms of causes. You want to describe what's happening without presupposing the fact that there are causes located here and there. You know, it's the thing that causes are located to the... In the first sentence of the second paragraph, he says, he opposes... And this is another big topic in the history of philosophy that I won't have time to get into, but he opposes explanation and understanding. An explanation is when you give causes for events, and understanding is something else, which can be intellectualist, purely conceptual, mental, or different from that. And the account that he's proposing is a different kind of understanding from what's happening. So he says that you can't give the cause of what's happening, because you would just have to say, well, he's been wounded here in his brain and stuff I'm not competent for. But, and this is what he says, everything Snyder has comes from a wound that's in the occipital lobe or sphere. I don't know the English word for this. Anyway.
Can I reword the question? Because I'm sorry, I was like
caught. No, but the thing is, so...
What is it about Snyder?
Well, precisely what Merleau-Ponty wants to say is that You can the best way to account for it, for the difference between Snyder and us, is the fact that he lacks this very sexual perception or the sexual intentionality. Precisely because he can't, he says he can't, because, I mean, think of the task of grasping something. The task comes to fulfillment when you grasp the glass. And the thing is, he says that, for Schneider, the intentionality is not fulfilled because he doesn't come to satisfaction. So the what he does when he's with a woman, what he says in the second paragraph is that you can't describe his behavior as something that's, or his conduct, as something that seems to be unified by the perspective of satisfaction in the sexual intercourse. Right? So this lack of meaning, sexual meaning in his behavior, is that by which Malvoisin lies on to say that he lacks this real level. So his aim is to wonder whether you can separate these layers of description. So they're useful to state. They're useful to understand precisely what he lacks in an existential way. That would be the answer.
In this situation, would you say that Schneider then is only operating at the pre-personal level? He can never move on to the personal level in sexual situations?
He's also got problems with the pre-personal level.
Because he can barely see, actually.
So support what you were saying in relation to the original intentionality. So specifically, I think in answer to the question which you said in your own words on the top of 181, that Schneider, well, the patient, what has disappeared from the patient is his power of projecting before himself a sexual world.
Yeah.
And so, that's, you know,
yeah, this is what I was heading towards before. There was a forest of hands raising.
Yes. So there's kind of a parallel to his argument here on the sexual dimension to the intellectual dimension and, I guess, the biological and perceptual dimension. And it's precisely this very peculiar problem of Schneider that he can't, project himself into a situation. He can't imagine, you know, he's not open to all these other possible situations that we're open to. And
so, in a way, you could say that he has his capacity to organize the world and to give meaning to it is just unbent, whereas our intentional arc is more bent. That's the way Malpoti put it, the flow of existence and everything. So that basically means that his behavior has less dynamism into it, sort of. And so that, you know, he says in the chapter when he discusses Schneider's case, in the first part, he says that on motility, he says that what would you say is sick or ill? I don't know. His impairment or disability ends up as disorganizing his experience. So it would mean that the world is not as articulated for him as for us, but also that the dimensions themselves come to be blurred in some way.
Yeah, well, he says there's a structural difference, so he even says that on 180, so it's kind of...
The structure is the world as being articulated, and the fact that this articulation has different layers.
Mm-hmm. And so since it's the power that he lost, so specifically he lost the power of projecting, so that's the case and seems to account for the fact that he can't learn things, I guess. I mean, I'm kind of wondering if Schneider could learn things in a way that when you learn a skill, that kind of more significance can come out. So it seems like he's stuck with what he's already learned, and so he can he still has the kind of motor intentionality like making a wallet, because he's not learning to make a wallet. He's already got it.
Well, I think you wouldn't have to conceive of a creative intentionality as primarily a learning process.
Well, I wouldn't consider it as primarily a learning process, but a necessary condition for being capable of learning something.
Yeah, but it's not the same. So, I mean,
right.
you could use it to characterize the learning impairment that he has, but you wouldn't want to start from the learning disabilities that he may have to characterize the operating intention.
Right. Ultimately, I was just trying to make sense of the fact that he can still make wallets.
Yeah, but it would probably be by following instructions that they're not oriented towards the production of the wallet, say, maybe. Mm-hmm. But this isn't very sexual.
So.
Sorry.
I don't want to hold you up, but just listen to the conversation here. Wouldn't the better word be impersonal rather than pre-personal?
Maybe. That's memorable. You say it's pre-personal.
But
the thing is,
no. Well, what did you say impersonal? Well, I don't think so, because if you say impersonal, I might need two lectures, actually, because I've only commented
two paragraphs, and there's eight.
No.
No, but let me say something.
I have to finish. No, you have to say pre-personal, because the thing is, and this helps me maybe clarifying, or maybe blurring for the people that I've lost already,
is that he talks at least three times, he talks about living men, living human beings, as being, he says, knowing organisms.
And this he deals with this also in the lectures on nature in the Collège de France, where he says that the peculiarity of the human animal is that he has logos. Okay. So this capacity to articulate the meanings of the world and to concentrate, to focus, say, on the even pre-personal level. But why is it important that you say pre-personal? Because of two things. First of all, it's the condition you have to, what Benvenuti says is that you're always, always doing something practical. So you're always, in your experience, drawn by some human motivations. He's being very clear about this. And this is why he says, for example, in the chapter on the thing, when he talks about the picture that you come to have the best vantage point on and blah, blah, blah. Well, you're in the museum, and the task you're performing is that you want to have the best vantage point on the picture. So even when you concentrate on purely sensory motor experience, you're doing something. It's a very peculiar way of having a task. Why is that? It's because you want to. You're in the attitude of knowledge. You want to have the knowledge of how it works for an embodied subject to perceive something. So you're performing a specific knowing or epistemic whatever task. First. Second, it's that, and this task relies on the fact that we humans can try to spell out, as painters, hence the parallel between phenomenology and painting, we can try to spell out the world as it is, in a purely natural way. But this purely natural way is only natural to us. The way it's being articulated only has a meaning for us because we have this body that's, and we have five senses and blah, blah, blah. So the thing is that even this very pre-personal dimension is, you can only have access to it when you're performing a personal task. And it's the condition of our having an experience that's always laden with personal motivations.
Yes, I think you're misunderstanding the force of my question. The way you characterized pre-personal was with respect to a level of abstraction of the objects to which we are directed. So you're not looking at the fact that that's money, you're just looking at its shape and its color. You're not thinking about that it's money. You're abstracting away from the things about it that might make it personally interesting.
Yeah, well, if this is what it means,
that's what I was just thinking.
Yeah.
Impersonal may be carried more neat, since we should have chosen that word.
But
that's compatible with everything you said about
it.
The
thing is, I think he wants to stress the fact that you can separate, the fact that we humans have an experience of the world in general, that we can just focus on the purely perceptual dimensions of our experience, unlike animals, because we're not always drawn by these.
The problem about the pre is that it suggests basicness or temporality. So you think that,
yes,
this is what behind James' question, you really see the rectangular greenness, and then you impose the knowledge that it's money, or the knowledge that it's sexual object.
This is not the way
you don't. So I was trying to find the word to get that.
That's, yeah, fair enough.
No, wait, please.
Five words, maybe, just to add to this. The reason I think that pre-personal is probably better than impersonal is it sounds like a necessary condition for the rest of the levels to go. You have to have the pre-personal level. Impersonal sounds logically separable.
Yeah, thanks. Yeah, I have to forget that. Right. Yeah.
I think this is an undergraduate class, and undergraduates should be participating too.
But
are you the only undergraduate?
Well, no, but, like, I'm one of them.
The other undergraduate spoke once, and you spoke it once.
You had a question.
Yeah, I was going to say the same thing as Jennifer. Impersonal, I think, Alva, is you can deal with people in an impersonal way, like in the bank or something. That's in the personal dimension and then brackets it. This is supposed to be foundational. It's supposed to be something that happens before the personal and the impersonal get into the act, which is, you see what I'm trying to say?
Well, yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Violette. Only if you say
so. Okay, so this big personal discussion anyway. I think it, well, what we started with was the fact that even though there was this necessary condition being the pre-personal level of the perception of the body as a thing, then sexual perception is a very original dimension, which necessary condition is this pre-personal level, but still it's an original form of experience in itself. Okay, so this is the thing that's being the most important in the second paragraph. So I will try to begin the third one before it stops, so I'm pretty late. So the thing is now, even though this very, the dimension of say, if you have a better word for this, I will certainly accept it, but I would call the level of perception, purely sensory motor perception, the level of pure perception. So that's why it's moving sort of between you and me. And it's very important, this level of perception of natural features of the things. Okay, this is a condition, but then there's a level of sexual perception. And the thing is that now it becomes a bit more tricky, because what Miller says is that within the different personal dimensions of existence, so not at this level of the perception of the shapes and everything, but so in at the very level of the personal things that we do, that's the knowing and the acting, beginning of the third paragraph, it's in the first sentence of the third paragraph. The knowing and the active and sexuality, so these are three.
Where are you getting this from?
The beginning of the third paragraph. He says, in English, thus sexuality is not an autonomous cycle. It has internal links with the whole active and cognitive being, these three sectors of behavior displaying but a single typical structure and standing in a relationship to each other of reciprocal expression. And so this is, well, I'll need another lecture because to explain the chapter for itself, sort of, we needed this, and especially the fact that the pre-personal level is a condition of personal life, but then within personal life, the two sentences that I've read are very important, because this is what Malopoti is going to be discussing until the end of the chapter. It's that the existence at its personal level since it always implies all the personal dimensions has one structure that you can find in them. So there's, and this is why he's starting with this global relationship between them. That's because obviously he wants to discuss the attacks that have been made against psychoanalysis, which is the main strategic, I think, one of the main strategic purposes that he has in this chapter. This is the fact, the very well-known fact that psychoanalysis has been reproached with reducing human life in general to what you do in bed, right? And actually what he wants to discuss is the fact that first of all, you have to understand what sexuality means to say this, and how it can be related to existence in general, and the fact that stating that you cannot separate sexuality from the rest of personal existence doesn't mean that you can reduce personal existence to sexual behaviors. Why? Because this would mean that when you're trying to understand the mathematical problem, you're not having the genuine experience of the original experience of trying to solve it. This is unauthentic, you might want to say, for example, which would mean that this is a, well, I can't say secondary now, so I have to find something else, but anyway, that this isn't an original dimension of experience. And so this is the point that Norbuti would be trying to make and to discuss in the rest of the chapter, is that this very peculiar relation between all the dimensions of personal, purely personal life, the human life that supervenes on top of the physical properties that we purely perceive. And what's the relation between what you do in life in general, how you behave with people, could be maybe more easily related to the very sexual conducts and behaviors and practices. So the thing is, what he will now try to find and try to explain, what he will now try to say is that he will try to explain how there can be and what would mean the fact that there's only what he calls one existential structure. That is, there's one, the personal life, and it's at the personal level that you can make differences between the existences of different human beings, you know, their temper, everything. They all reflect, they're all parts of one existential structure that expresses itself in all the dimensions of the personal experience. But stating that sexual, I repeat this because that's what I will discuss Thursday. It's the fact that saying this and saying that you cannot, that sexuality is an irreducible dimension of personal life, doesn't mean that you have to reduce the other dimensions to sexuality. Do you have any questions?
I thought that was a very important sentence about the single typical structure. You said single existential structure. Is that in the French, or is this a mistranslation?
No, he says existential structure. Yeah.
Because I'm happy if he gets it. Single typical structure is very boring. Single existential structure is a lot more.
Because he says... he says that there's only one existential attitude.
Okay. That's good. And what does it mean? I mean, this is a sort of two-part question. Okay, suppose it is a single existential structure, which I'm sure is what he really would say. What is this single existential structure? I, not to be mysterious, I would say it's movement toward a maximum grip. But if that isn't what it is, then I want to know what it is.
Well, the thing is, it allows for, well, that's what the rest of the chapter is explaining, but...
Good. I can wait.
Okay. Good. I'm trying to get a very short answer to your question, if possible. No.
Okay. Well,
so you'll have to wait, sorry.
It could be harder than what I just said, but I don't know what that's going to, I'm eager to hear, but... I'll wait till next time.
Okay, so this is what we're heading towards now. So it's very important to have in mind even this first sentence, thus sexuality is not an autonomous cycle, because this is what we've been discussing all along. Okay. So to begin answering your question, Bert, the thing is that what you see when he quotes Freud, There's a word in italics, I don't know. For you, it could be page 183. Just after the sentence of the sexuality not being an autonomous cycle. So he says that in this, I'll go first on this paragraph. Well, he says just before that this italic consciousness, whatever the theoretical declarations of Freud may have been, psychoanalytical research is in fact led to an explanation of man, not in terms of his sexual substructure, as if this would be the primary layer, right? And you have to have this substructure in mind, because at the very end of the chapter, he discusses, in a very long footnote, he discusses the sort of bad understanding that you could have of psychoanalysis, and he compares it with what Marx said. So have this just work, this substructural approach in mind as something he wants to criticize. So it's a discovery in sexuality of relations and attitudes which had previously been held to reside in consciousness. So this, what does it mean? It means that it's a way to stress his commitment to the third way, or to the way of existence. It's that the relations between these three do not come because there's a single subject, single mental, intellectual subject, that would be the identical subject in these dimensions. There's something else, or the common existential structure that they have doesn't simply come from the fact that there's a single consciousness experiencing these dimensions. There's something more, and not very surprisingly, I admit, it's the fact that the subject that experiences all these personal dimensions is an embodied subject. So the thing is, the way of existence will have to help us understand why the fact that the subject is embodied is crucial to understand the fact that there's one existential structure common to all the personal dimensions. So that's what I was also heading towards when I said that one of the aims of the chapter is to understand what Merleau-Ponty means by body. The fact that there's a very basic identical meaning of the term body that's present throughout the book. Well, hopefully, because that's what he's trying to stress, the fact that perception is embodied interaction with the world and with people in it. So what I'll be trying to explain next time is how the body plays a role in defining the existential structure that's common to all the dimensions of life, including sexuality. Because you might want to think that you might want to stick to this, say, reductionist substructural view, according to which sexuality is the bottom of the rest of life, meaning that the rest of life should be reduced to sexuality, because when you're, say, reflecting on your math homework, you'd be more detached from your body than you are when you're in bed with someone, right? But this is not true for Merleau-Ponty. There's an identical meaning of the body that's present in this experience, because the attitude, the general existential attitude that you have, can only be understood thanks to the way you behave in an, say, embodied manner.
We have 2 minutes.
Yes, can I say something more? Can I say something?
Yeah.
Okay, I'll set up a problem for next time, because I disagree completely with your reading of this sentence, which is such an important sentence. I think it's a single typical structure. It doesn't say existential structure. I wish it did,
But the single typical structure isn't maximum grip. I take that back. It's something sexual. I mean, the way the sentence goes, I mean, the sexuality isn't an anonymous cycle. It's something like the single typical structure in all of these things. The single typical, I think, is a sexual structure. Now, what?
But he doesn't say single typical sexual structure.
No, but he doesn't say it's a central structure. And in the context, talk about context, I mean, it's in the scope of talking about sexuality. Wouldn't you not want to say that there's something typical of thinking, of acting, of all these things, which is their sexual dimension, and that's what we're going to talk about. That's what it looks like it says. Now
that doesn't make any sense to me, because it says sexuality is not an autonomous cycle, and then he says it has internal links with the whole active and cognitive being, and then he says these three sectors.
This is why he says that there's a common existential attitude to all these dimensions.
Well, I would have thought sexuality was a common
existential attitude. No. There's something deeper than only sexual conduct.
Okay.
Means that you can't only refer to sexual conduct to understand what people are doing in life in general. There's something that's the common dimension to all.
Yes, okay. And my only question is a textual one. I want to see what typical gets ahead, not as existential. And then I want to know, what does existential mean? It turns out to be, it sounds terribly empty, the structure of everything. Okay, we got another lecture.
Olivia, the intentional structure is the structure of
oh, no friend
right now.
You need to be on the
yeah, you could have it.
I'm not sure.